So during our discussion, yeah, at the second minute, boom.
Hello, everybody. Here at 3D Natives, we've been analyzing the global changes in the additive manufacturing industry. And of course, we've talked a lot about China. China clearly has momentum. And to dive deeper into this, we are here today with Gil Lavi from 3D Alliances. Thank you very much, Gil.
Thank you for having me, Filippos.
So Gil, you've been in additive manufacturing long enough. How do you see the evolution from when you started to today?
The goal of the additive companies was to change the way prototypes are made, taking it from a manual process to a digital process. If you look at the industry today, we can split it into two different solution segments or types: prototyping solutions and manufacturing solutions. Back then, we didn't have any manufacturing solutions. In the prototyping solutions, the polymer side is a major force, and the solutions that you have in order for people to make fast prototyping from different kinds of materials and technologies. On the manufacturing, we're seeing in the past several years a strong increase in using metal 3D printers for producing and use parts.
So yes, indeed, rapid prototyping has been the norm, manufacturing has been the promise. From back then to today, would you say that we've seen more cases of actual manufacturing? And how about that in China specifically?
So I think that today we are seeing the adoption of additive in manufacturing for specific industries, specific applications, but it has to be an end-to-end solution. I think end users today understand that in order to integrate additive in producing end-use parts, you need to have an end-to-end solution that can make sure the process is stable enough to produce repeatable results.
Would you say that Chinese players are bridging that gap now?
What's happening in China is really interesting. That generally, there is a lot of manufacturing, metal manufacturing in China. The focus is to make the process more efficient and cheaper. The government supports this kind of activity. This is why we're seeing an increased number of metal, Chinese metal companies, that it's not, they do not only get the support from the government in terms of financing or different kind of tax, they're also getting the right projects. If I summarize what's happening in China, China is one big box of things that happening inside the country, which are not related to US and Europe at all. There is a line of companies, specifically metal companies in China, that are ready and eager to go to US and Europe, and they understand what it takes.
Clearly, we see a lot of domestic activity in the Chinese market. China is a huge economy. Does China actually have the potential of being the global powerhouse that the US or Europe have been in the past?
As long as the activity of additive and the industry is growing inside China, it doesn't necessarily mean that it can increase in the same ratio in US and Europe. Here comes a different challenge of Chinese companies when they grow abroad. One challenge is, first of all, explaining and presenting their technology and what makes it unique. Number two is, it's a very important aspect, is the support. When you have a problem, you stop manufacturing. Usually you have a problem. Now the question is, even if you get the printer for free, right, and you're going to manufacture 5,000 parts a month, if you're going to stop in the middle and your manufacturing will stop and it will affect the entire chain,
you can't afford it.
You cannot afford it.
So customer service then, after sales.
Exactly.
There's been this notion of Chinese manufacturers often having technologies that pre-existed in the US, in Europe, even the Middle East, that have been out there and they have been reproduced in a faster way or cheaper way or some sort of alteration of that technology. Do you see Chinese companies innovating at the level Europe and the US has in the past?
The key advantage that they have is scaling. I had the chance to visit different kind of companies at their headquarters. And in many cases, you can see that Chinese companies has two different business units. One is selling services, and the other one is selling printers. Doesn't matter if it's polymers or metal. So this combination of understanding the customer needs, providing services, printing parts, and then selling a machine, when they sell a machine, they sell it with all the knowledge that they have. So they can address a specific industry, a specific application, not just theoretically explaining what they can do with the printers, but they can show case studies from actual products.
And as we're wrapping up, the last year or two have been pretty tough on additive manufacturing, especially for the West. A lot of the biggest Chinese players have grown a lot in market cap. How do you see that moving forward in 2026 and 2027, 2028? Is the momentum going to continue?
Western companies are very strong in innovation. Chinese companies are very strong in scaling. So if you push Chinese products into the market, I think Western companies, I'm sure, will have to accelerate innovation and to invent new technologies that the Chinese do not have, or it will take the time to catch up. In additive, I sense that the next job is coming, technological leap, and it will come from the West.
Well, we like to listen to your gut feeling, and thank you very much, Gil, for sharing your expertise once again.
Thank you very much.
And to our audience at 3D Natives, thank you very much for watching this video. We would love to know your opinion. Feel free to let us know. What are your thoughts on the Chinese additive manufacturing market? Let us know in the comments below, and stick around for more videos on 3dnatives.com.